what has been their idea, what has been that path-breaking idea or a venture. And then they will share the experience of execution, how challenging it was to implement that particular idea or execute that particular venture. And then when they did this, so that we can learn from their experience, when they did that, what has been the impact? Or what is the potential impact they anticipate by their idea and by their venture?
We are a mobile data collection platform. The idea behind our platform was to get NGOs to share their data with other NGOs and to share their data with their donors. We started 2 years ago, and I don't have much time, I'll just quickly jump into the execution and impact part of it. So the idea was that this sector, there's a lot of data collection, a lot of analysis organizations do within themselves, but there's not much sharing of this between organizations and with their donors. So we've been doing this for 2 years, and while our idea was great, we thought it would work. It turns out no NGO wants to share its data. Nobody wants to share their data. We learned it the hard way. We were willing to offer the whole platform for free to NGOs to share the data, but they're more than willing to pay us for it so that they don't have to share it. Donors are not interested in wanting to look at the data on a regular basis. They are happy with their yearly reports. So what happened to our innovation? Well, we're now trying to figure out if that's not what the market wants, how do we go about it? The flip side is the platform has worked very well. There's a lot of, we have 25 NGOs collecting data on our platform. We collect about, so far we've collected about 350,000 data points or forms. These are forms that people can fill up and submit data. And the impact within the organizations have been good. There's better management, better analysis of what they're doing in real time. But beyond that, we are still, I'll be open to discuss.
Hello, everyone. I'm Satvik. I run a company called Aquasafi. Aquasafi is in the clean water space. 144 million Indians do not have access to safe water. Closer home in Karnataka, about 60% people have access to water which has more fluoride than is acceptable in drinking water. I don't think I need to emphasize the problem of contaminated water. 80% of diseases are waterborne. So our solution to this is to have community water stores where water is sold to villagers at a very low cost. So typically between 10 to 20 paisa per liter is what water is sold at. We have a reverse osmosis based system which we install in a village location or any underserved location. And the unit is actually set up through an NGO or through the local government, the panchayat, or through a local micro-entrepreneur that we identify in that village. And if the micro-entrepreneur does not have funds to buy that equipment, then we help him get those funds working with partners like Microgram and Milab, which are crowdsourcing platforms, microfinance platforms. So we do this. Right now, we are present in about 50 villages, all in Karnataka. Mostly in North Karnataka, but we have a few down south near Bangalore as well. And about 50,000 people get their daily drinking water from our units. And we actually collect data on a daily basis about our units. And we share that data with our customers. So the customer has access to his units. So for example, one NGO has eight water units. So they would have access to all those eight water units, where they can see the number of customers taking water daily, the water quality, as well as certain system parameters as to how is the system functioning, so that we know in advance if there's any problem with the functioning of the system.
We work in Lucknow with graduates, BAs and BCOMs at government and government-aided colleges. We run a program basically after their regular class timings for the whole of their third year, and then we work with them on career services to try to get them placed in local, primarily entry-level service and sales positions. In terms of, the main idea or objective is to, kind of improve employment outcomes amongst these plain graduates in Lucknow and hopefully eventually in other parts of Eastern UP. We've been doing it for 3 years, since January of 2011. I think, you know, our challenges maybe were very similar. I think that we felt that, you know, we were going to build this curriculum and everyone would want to enroll in this course. It's heavily subsidized to the student. The student does pay something, and employers pay when students get placed as well. But I think we found out that, you know, maybe not as many people were interested in spending 2 hours after their regular classes coming for additional training. So we've, you know, I guess in some ways haven't met our expectations in terms of number of students enrolled. And I think that's been our biggest challenge in terms of just pure demand for the program. In our first year of training, we had around 20 students in two colleges. And then this is our kind of second full year of training students, and it's we have around 50 students in three colleges. And so there's been some gradual growth and some gradual improvement, but I think that's been our biggest sort of humbling experience that has happened. In terms of the impact, though, I think we do feel, you know, maybe similar to Mitesh as well, that the program works in the sense that, you know, we see a pretty significant difference from the beginning to the end with the students. And so we have around 100 days, 2 hours a day with them. So that's 200 hours. And then there's also an on-the-job kind of internship training component. In terms of, you know, kind of placement rates in these internships and in full-time positions, it's very high, like above 75-80%. So I think we feel like in our outcomes with this small group of students is working, we feel that, you know, there's clearly a change in their ability to successfully get a job and succeed in that job. But, you know, that's been our story so far.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Ajay, and I work with the program called Leaders Accelerating Development. That's one of the programs, the very initial programs of Deshpande Foundation. This program is like very simple. The idea of this program is to turning ideas into action. So what does it happen in this program? It's like we work quite similar. Like he does like more like training the college students and making them more like employable and then connecting with the employer. Where what happens in the LEAD program, we work with the college students with all kind of education, engineering or technical, non-technical or anybody. And the idea is like in the college life, I think we all have experienced and many people are experiencing in this audience. In the college life, we got a lot of ideas. It may be related to your studies, any technical subject you study, and then you think, I can put into action practically, I can do something. But restriction is that's not your practical subject, and none of the faculties or principal will allow you because that's not going to be graded. Another thing is you may see some problems in the community, and you think that, oh, I want to do something for the community, I want to solve this problem, and I have an idea, solution to solve it, and then there is no platform for it. So LEAD program works to giving a platform to the students to implement their ideas into action. That's the main thing. So that is like very much open program, voluntary program. And as of now, I think we started in 2008 this program from this college with a dozen of students. And as of now, we are running with more than 75 colleges with 17,990 students we have reached with them. And every year around 3,000 students join the program.
This is Srikant Bola. I am representing Asadeep Projects Private Limited. Of course, I'm the kind of a sales guy in the company, you should say, though I'm a founder. But anyway, so it's a fast-growing social enterprise which is in the consumer product and packaging space. What's so unique about it? You might think, what's so special about this, right? You can start, I can start, anybody can start. So I want to just talk about why am I doing what am I doing and how. Why does it matter and how we calculate it, right? So basically, just to talk about the problem, India faces a unique problem of huge unemployment in general. And when you take a deeper look at the disabled population of the country, we have over 80 plus million people which constitutes of major disabilities. Among which 90% of them are not formally educated or qualified to enter into mainstream inclusive work environment. Even though this 10% who can work in the mainstream work environment, corporations are not ready yet to include them into the work climate because they don't have the support systems and there's a big stigma out there. They have to walk that extra mile to accommodate these people. why do they do all these things? Because most of them are not no social entrepreneurs like you or like me. They're just regular entrepreneurs whose job is to make money. So who is going to solve it? And we have seen 60 years of independence, but things have not changed. So, I mean, I myself, being challenged, had to suffer so many things, but have achieved significant growth and education by graduating from MIT and whatnot. But not everybody can have this opportunity. It matters to me because I have this responsibility of changing the society around me, creating a better India. And this is what made us to start a company rather than just inspiring people who doesn't take this inspiration. As this gentleman rightly said, the inspiration goes beyond the doors. So we want to continue that inspiration. That is why we started a professional company which aims at and which leverages employment opportunities for this 80 plus million people who are not educated and are not skilled. So we get people whom nobody wants. So we take people who does not even know what school is, what education is, how what the behavior is, and then we turn them into productive workforce. So they, when I talk about execution point of it, is that's the toughest part, right? So you're taking somebody who's like an unfinished coal block and turning them into a mere gold or diamond whom everybody wants is the toughest challenge. And that is not tough for us because we have a dedicated special education team who really looks at each case by case, acquires them to work roles. And the main thing is we re-engineer all our machines. So we don't simply use a packaging machine or a cutting machine just out of the box. We just take it, think outside the box, and then go out of the way and re-engineer the machine to make it more adaptable and accessible to be used by the people with, you know, maybe no limbs or no hands or something. So add extra levers, add extra blades, or add whatnot. So that's the key. Those expertise of ours will enable them to be productive workforce who can actually work better than our able-bodied workforce. Just to give you a statistic numbers, we have hired over 30 plus disabled people, which includes hearing impaired, MR, mentally challenged, cerebral palsy, the physically challenged, blind people, and whatnot. So, and we generate revenue over 10 lakhs with a net of 15%, and we are competing in an unfragmented and unorganized sector. Because in India, paper industry is very fragmented. So our challenge is to go up there, build the brand, occupy the name, and then inspire the entire global businesses. Hey, look, guys, build a business around the needs of the common people, our needs of the underprivileged, and needs of the businesses, so that you can combine both together to achieve significant economic development, which, you know, Mohan was talking about. Because in India, economic sector has slowed down due to lack of manufacturing. So manufacturing has larger role to play, and we have a better role to create the change. So finally, when I talk about the impact, right? So we have very clear impact at an individual level. All our people were left out of the economy. Nobody knows who they are. But now they have social status. They have financial status. They can make a decent living because of the money they earn. So they pay taxes. So the economy grows. This is the economic development. And the social development is the social status. And overall, the country develops because the significant portion of the people have been leveraged in the form of sustainable living. Thank you so much.
Hey, I'm Ronak. I'm the founder of Now Floats. I'm a geek. He's a sales guy. I'm a geek. I'm a tech guy. For me, technology is always simple. But what I want to do, my vision is there are 47 million local businesses in India. This country is a country of shopkeepers. How I really want to simplify the way they access technology and the way they use technology. Look at Walmart. Look at Amazon is entering India. Look at Flipkart. Right? These SMBs do not understand technology today. For them, it's a Janjat, as they call it in Hyderabad. It's a janjat for them to go online and get into the website thing. So what we built is, if you're a local business and you do not understand technology, pick up a phone with 3 SMS, and by the time this gentleman finishes a speech, you will be online. Pick up a phone, send SMS, float to 5676787878, and within the next 15 minutes, you will have your own online presence up and running, which you can completely manage using SMS. So that's what we do. So the next thing is, okay, this is that, but then what's our main USP, right? Our USP is the way we simplify things. So the first, what I highlighted was the simplification of content creation. SMS is just a channel. But the second reason why today merchants, the local businesses, are not online, you know, because they create a website, but that doesn't drive any kind of revenue, right? You don't get any ROI or any revenue out of your, you don't get any customers out of the website. What's the point? So what we did, instead of asking the SMBs to buy stuff and do SEO, the search and optimization, we wrote machine learning algorithms to completely do automated SEO for them. We made content creation simple, and our machine automatically understands what the SMB does, what is he trying to sell, what are the products in his market, and we automatically optimize his site for someone, a guy searching in Google for that product or that service in his area. And that's what we enable. And about the impact, today we have 5,000 local businesses using the product. And not only local businesses, but we have Nokia, Samsung, Mom and Me, if you're from Bangalore, Printo, Hashbro, Basics Life, they're all paid customers on my platform. Because not in the local businesses, but the Nokia guy, what if you're searching for a Nokia Lumia 720 in Hubli? Do you ever see a Nokia store come online? No. And India's search market is growing 140% every year. And that's where they're losing out. So not only the small businesses, but big enterprises who sell through retail, they also need local discovery. Today we have that, and we also have 1,000 customers outside India. We have customers in South Africa, in Canada, in US, in Mexico, and Indonesia. Yeah, we have a good traction here because every local business needs local discovery, and that's what we're here to solve, to ensure people drive ROI from their online business and they see value in it.
There are 230 million young men under the age of 18 in India alone, and the numbers aren't perfect, but what we understand is that as many as 118 million of these young men are going to grow up and they are going to hit women. And as many as 58 million are going to grow up and they're going to rape women. Now, this is not a problem that's exclusive to India. This is a problem that's actually across South Asia. It's a problem in Asia. It's a problem in the country that I'm from, which is the UK. It's a problem from North America. It's particularly problematic in South America. But this is a global epidemic that is rarely talked about. Every key issue in India is typically characterized by women being worse off than men. And the majority of the solutions that are promoted to tackle these problems place the burden of change on women. We believe that has to change. And so Equal Community Foundation is trying to give every young man in India the opportunity to study and start to practice gender equitable behavior. And we've developed a series of simple, practical programs that we deliver in 20 communities across Pune, with a total population of 40,000 people. Over 3,000 young men between the age of 14 and 18 have enrolled into our programs. Nearly 2,000 have graduated from our programs. And 60% of the women who live with these men experience a significant reduction in physical violence or discrimination. The future of achieving gender equality lies with working with young men. And it's an area that we're pioneering in Pune, and hope to scale out to Delhi later this year. And then through training programs for the social sector and later the educational sector, ensure that in the community and at school, young men are raised to respect women.
I'm Girish Bharadwaj from border of Kerala, Karnataka. Basically, I'm a mechanical engineer. Among the galaxy of the panelists, I'm the senior most, little outdated, but my works are not outdated, I am confident. Correcting villages. I started with my workshop of engineering 40 years ago in my hometown. I was connected with the repairing of farm machinery and constructing gobar gas plants. The idea is the generates the solution to problems. Necessity is the mother of invention. And people wanted to cross the river. They came and requested me. I was mechanically, I was not knowing anything about bridge construction. It is a civil engineering subject. But they could not listen to my plea that I don't have experience. We tried, we built a bridge. It was a great success. I never dreamt that I will have to build any more bridges. But later, government officials and the elected members found that this is the easiest means for making people to cross. Started funding. We constructed more and more bridges. I trained my people who were workshop fabricators to construct bridges. And we are happily we are doing it. The people's gratitude, it motivated us. In some places throughout the year, there is no connectivity. When we finish the work and start from that village, people used to come with their eyes wet with the happiness, and in some places, they used to touch the feet and give a farewell. It inspired. I started working. Later, the challenge was the Transparency Act came in the government. Everything was to be given as a tender, contract. I registered as a contract because this inspiration was to build bridges. It is not the measurement or money. The bridges have got a lot of impact on the lives of people. So we started, I became a contractor. Afterwards, I had a lot of bitter experience. My path was sweet, bitter, and spicy also many times. I wanted to give up at that when I completed almost 45 bridges. I thought I will just complete 50 and give up. For my living, I got a workshop. It is enough. Then somehow people won't leave me, and elected members also won't leave me. So I thought I will build bridges if somebody else is the contractor. So I requested district administration, the Nirmiti Kendras are under district collector. So afterwards I built many of the bridges and through Nirmiti Kendra. They are the contractors. Monetary profit, I am not bothered. Those people supply all the material, and I take my people out, salary and our conveyance, everything is paid by the Nirmiti Kendra. And I am having the profit of the gratitude of people. And for my living, I got the workshop. The challenge we used to face was, sometimes people used to think, even the government official, they used to think that it is a profit-making business without any risk. But I have been hardened to see that their incapability to build this type of bridges is an opportunity, to turn it as an opportunity for me to continue. Now we have extended our activities to Andhra Pradesh, and now working in Orissa. Orissa is a very tough place, Naxal affected, but we are gaining the love of those people when we create connectivity. I improved my designs, made it more stable, more economical, and made it still look more aesthetically more beautiful. And my bridges are bridges of love. Thank you.
So in my college of 2,000 students, hardly 100 of them have BPL mobile SIM cards. BPL is a mobile phone operator in India at that point. So why don't you come out with a CUG plan, a closed user group plan, which will help students really connect with each other? They said, let's do it. Because their area sales managers were doing something like 10 SIMs a week. And what's wrong in trying? So we went ahead and suggested a plan. So you recharge for 2,000 rupees, you'll get so much talk time free, so many SMSs free, etc. And they said, let's try. So what happened was, we had this huge peer network. And while their area sales managers were doing 10 SIMs a week, we were able to do 100 SIMs on the first day. Since it's friends, and it's easy for me to call you and say that, take the SIM, I can call you for 20 paise a week, a day. And over the next 3 months, we sold close to 10,000 SIMs. We made close to 7 lakhs. We got all the bikes, mobile phones. We had dinner, lunch, and Leela's, etc. And we splurged. 3 months later, we are back to zero. We wanted more money. We go back to BPL Mobile and say, give us more SIM cards. They say, no, our dealers are creating problems for us. because you are not even a company. So we ask them, what do you want? Do you want a company? They say, yes. We go ahead and register a partnership firm. So I registered my first company when I was in my third year of engineering, and this is how we started. It was fun. We slowly started expanding into SMSC, US SSD, all the jazz that goes with mobile telephony, because it was fun doing all of that. In my final year of engineering, I raised close to 80 lakhs in investment. That's around $100,000. And from 2006, December, when we raised the funding, to 2012, we have had a gross turnover, net revenue of over 200 crores. We have had around 40 crores in profit. We have paid the government close to 25 crores in taxes. But while all of this was happening, there were many people who were coming to us and saying that we too want to do what you're doing. We too want to start a company. We too have an idea. Can you help us? And we kept on telling them that this is what we did, this is what we did. We used to give them a couple of lakhs, 50,000, 25,000, so that they could buy their first mobile phone, the first laptop on which they could code, etc. And we kept doing this. So in 2009, another person from the northern end of Kerala, that's my state, came and he said he wants to do something similar. His name was Deepak Ravindran. He is now on the MIT Technology Under 35, TR MIT Under 35 list. He is Asia 21 leader. He runs the world's largest offline search on internet. The name of the company is Innos. This is a company that we funded again. And what happened was that we were seeing so many of such people coming and we were helping them. But we had not yet put a name to that process. In the US, this is known as the incubation. So we were actually practically running an incubator, but we had not put a name to it. And that's when we met with one Mr. Dr. Mittal, the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. So incubators are the breeding breeds of boards of incubation and innovation. You have incubator, there is natural innovation. Economy betters, more companies come about. US has around 4,000 incubators, China around 2,000. India at that point in 2009 had around 65. So if India has to go anywhere in terms of innovation and more entrepreneurship, we need to have at least 1,000. This is something which is being laid out in the Planning Commission document as well. So we meet Mr. Mittal, a senior IS officer, and he tells us this is the problem. And we say, we have a solution. What is it? We say a PPP model, a public-private partnership model, wherein the private sector is given the responsibility of vision and execution, while the government sector does the infrastructure and the policy with it, because that's what they do best, and private sector is really good in execution. We gave this proposal in 2009. Government is government. It took 3 years to come through, 3 years for the approval. We launched the incubator finally in 2012, April. The incubator's name is Startup Village. I'm the chief operating officer of Startup Village right now. I've completely exited the other firm. And when we started in April 2012, our stated vision was to create 1,000 technology startups in 10 years and start the search for a $1 billion startup from campuses by the turn of the decade, by 2020. April 2012, we start. As on date, we have had over 1,500 applications. We have incubated close to 450 companies, and of which around 150 are student startups. Student startups mean all of them are still in college. 50 are physically incubated, of which 30 have raised funding. 3 of them have been bought out, $1 million acquisitions, and the going has been generally good.
So since yesterday, after I watched LEAD program, I was just thinking, how can I describe? Every year I come and every year I discover things. So what I discovered in the last, say, 24 hours or so, or maybe perhaps 30 hours, is this. So I can describe this particular event with four I's. This is a confluence of ideas, individuals, and institutions. And all of them, they are trying to make an impact. So it's ideas, individuals, institutions making an impact. I think that's how I feel, and I'm getting realized about this particular dialogue and this foundation. So, and this is not that I come only once in a year. I in between come, spend a couple of days teaching innovation, entrepreneurship, and so on to the fellows here. About this, after listening to all these 9 change makers or path breakers or whatever great things that they have done. In fact, I heard a couple of times, wow. I think wow is the greatest way to appreciate something truly great. So what does this tells me, I mean, after listening to them, I think there are two things that comes to my mind. The first thing is hope. I think there is a hope. When we have people like this and we have foundation like this, I think this gives me a hope. Because when I look around, everywhere there is a negativity. Everywhere this thing, but after listening, after experiencing this, there is a hope. And also, it gives me a confidence that there is a it is possible. See, all these people have made impossible possible. I don't think any one of us, in fact, my next question was about empathy, compassion, inner calling, and so on. So I think we can, the takeaway, or we can go away from this particular room is that there is a hope, very, very strong hope, and there is a possibility. Thank you very much.